Please do not cut my new videos take too damn long to edit.
Are we yapping about Faye? Okay.
Love you forever, but sometimes we seem to disagree. Pray that you protect her and increase my sympathy. I'm a mini you, one day I'll have a mini me. I'm your son, I shouldn't treat you like an enemy. I get annoyed when you point out all my tendencies.
If you asked me 2 years ago what my favorite anime were and what I consider the best anime of all time, it probably consists of like Summertime Rendering, Hunter x Hunter, Dragon Ball Z, Slime, and the Fate series. All those are still on there, by the way. With some new additions, but I'm not gonna lie, there's a couple that I haven't seen since my first watch of them, and Fate is one of them. I feel like it's about that time to start Fate Zero again. Going into this rewatch, I already knew that it was gonna be one of the best anime ever, but I guess I needed a refresher course on why and what made me love it so much. And it's pretty safe to say that this shit is still elite in every aspect, gang. Being able to watch through like a different lens has made it feel like I was watching a new show altogether. Before, I was straight like an action junkie, so like to get me, all you really needed was like some flashy and visually appealing fight scenes with a good amount of fights, and you pretty much got me at that point. Now, don't tweet. I still like fight scenes now, but I pay attention a lot now. So if it's like a story-driven narrative, I'm definitely locked in when it comes to the narrative of the show. So I'm looking forward to this, but that's enough yapping, folks. Let's get into it. So, you know, we do things around here. First, we start off with the story. The story in Fate is actually super unique now that I'm taking a more objective look at the show. And I think it still offers one of the best narratives in all of anime, even after the rewatch. Like I said, it's been a few years since I've watched this. It damn near feel like watching this for the first time again. The beginning sequence was actually really refreshing to watch again. It's cool to see all these familiar faces again. I definitely had a couple, oh, I remember this nigga type moments. One thing that I think they did really well in the beginning that I didn't notice before is them already like foreshadowing internal conflicts for certain characters from the moment we see them. When we first get introduced to Emiya and his wife Iris, Iris just birthed their daughter Ilya, and bro couldn't look any more depressed. Nigga looked like he wanted a son. Like, that's how sad he looked. He was just across the room looking out the window. Actually, I think one of the first times he opened his mouth, he says, "I will be the cause of your death." Like, okay. Like, I could tell you didn't have a baby shower. And I could tell you didn't bust that fit in that sacred Burberry shirt during said baby shower. Didn't even glance over, folks. Iris was telling him to come hold his daughter. And I think he said he's not worthy to hold her, almost as if he's afraid to taint her type shit. We can kind of see the way he was acting. And, like, he was dealing with a lot of shit. And, gang, what did DJ Jumba say? And that's only the intro. Because, nigga, we ain't even know the half of it. Kari's conflict was a little bit more obvious and on the nose. Because the catalyst was his initial interaction with Aoi and Rin. Once he found out they sent Sakura to the Mato family, he already has something to fight for. And him being from the Mato family, he knows that the head of the family, Zoken, is a sick-ass nigga. So he's wondering what kind of sick nigga would send his daughter to a place like this. So he already had beef with Rin and Sakura's father. Kira's conflict was a little bit more complex and harder to see. You could tell something was wrong, but I think it was more through his lack of emotional response or lack of emotion in general. Like, we found out that he's like an executioner pretty early on, but he was kind of on the other side of the spectrum than Emiya was, because they're both executioners. Emiya hides his emotions, and you can see he's trying to hide them. You can see he's tired of going through shit. But Kira doesn't have any connections to anyone, and it seems like he's just like an emotional black hole. But as time unfolds, he starts to realize that he actually has desires, but he doesn't know what he desires, so that's why he's participating in the Grail War to find the answer. The whole dynamic of the Grail War was actually pretty unexpected, too. See, when you watch Fate for the first time, but the tone of it, it seemed like it's just going to be a straight up like battles between the servants, and it's just going to be like straight up fight in a somewhat like unorganized fashion, if that makes sense. And I'm not gonna lie, in my first watch, I didn't expect the servants to be like so much more than just pawns to fight, but Fate did a good job of making them feel just as important as their masters. They get used to the current world, and they have their own motives for the Grail themselves, and they even have these real like well-written dialogues with their masters and other servants, which challenges their life philosophies and ideas. And there's quite a few examples of this that I really want to talk about, so let's get into them. The first notable example was tossed between Gilgamesh, Ryder, and Saber. This is probably one of the one times in the story that I thought Saber was being a straight up dickhead, but Gilgamesh being here made this funny as hell. So if you don't remember, Ryder advised Saber and Gilgamesh because they're kings, and he advised them to have a drink and pick their brains and see what their philosophy is when it comes to being a king and what being a king is to them. First things first, it's funny as hell, I gotta mention this, Gilgamesh took a sip of that wine that Ryder bought, and then he was like, damn, boy, this shit weak. And he fucking pulled some Casamigos out of Babylon. And, like, this shit's funny as hell, for he just got the shit talking the entire time. But Ryder says that he wants to conquer the world with the Grail. He talks about his escapades from his past life and how he used to take to build his empire and earn the title of King of Conquerors. Ryder talks about how being loud and greedy are qualities of a good leader, and it lights a spark from within your followers and makes them want to be more like you. And I think Gilgamesh shares his ideals on what kings should be as well. I forgot what he said specifically, but Saber just shits on both of their philosophies. Like, straight up, like, just calls whatever they believe in stupid type shit. And then she shares hers. And then this nigga Gilgamesh just gets the cackling at her goof ass. And Ryder just got to cooking her shit after he heard why she wanted the Grail. Then her little immature ass was like ready to fight niggas. Like, nah, sit your fat head ass down somewhere, dude. I hate niggas that try to criticize everyone, but can't take no criticism for themselves. Saber's being an absolute dickhead right here. I hated it. Another example of this, Saber's final battle versus Lancer. And gang, I can't sit here and not talk about this episode, bro. It's probably one of my favorite episodes in the show, because Emiya is a savage-ass, funny-ass nigga. I'm not gonna lie, I didn't notice the first time. The second time around, it looked like Emiya was just trying to be cool. Like, the nigga was actually trying to do everything in his power to carry out Saber's wishes and actually respect the 1v1 and give her the fight that she'd been waiting for this whole time. He was being quiet and shit. He was negotiating, not trying to distract Saber in her long way to fight against Lancer. I thought he was just playing this move, but now he respected the duel, folks. Hell no. So he makes this deal with Caleb, and he makes Caleb sign this unbreakable agreement. And one of the terms are he must forfeit his command seals and drop out of the war. So I'm like, okay, that's reasonable. Lancer probably gonna still be there. In exchange, Emiya literally won't be able to kill him. And considering that he has every advantage right now, it'd be stupid not to sign it. So he does. All of a sudden, this nigga Lancer just stabs himself mid-fight and just get the screaming out shit like, you an anti-chivalrous ass bitch. I knew I should have left your grimy ass alive. I should have known you wasn't gonna respect the one. It's cool. You gonna have to respect the ones when I meet you down in hell, because I'm gonna beat the shit out of you when you get there. Then the nigga Emiya reveals the extra term of the agreement that they did not say, which said that Caleb had to use his remaining command spells to make Lancer kill himself. And I was like, damn, Emiya, you a cold-hearted ass nigga. But it gets worse. So Kano's sitting there rolling up to folks in the wheelchair like, hey, folks, so the contract is active, right? You can't kill me, right? Emiya say, hell no, I can't. And then all of a sudden, this nigga Kano getting hit with some big shit. Bullets was eating this nigga chest alive, folks. Then that nigga Emiya pull out a square and says, well, I can't. Blow the smoke out that bitch for a walk though. And it cuts to Maya horoscope and the motherfucking MW2 Watch 2000. Emiya gang, I'm not gonna lie, you lose a couple points for the square. But that was some cold-hearted shit, and I loved every bit of it. That ain't even really what I wanted to talk about for real. That scene was just funny as hell. And it just brings me joy every time I talk about it. When Saber got mad at him for this is the part that I wanted to initially talk about. I think this is where Emiya finally started to explain himself to Saber for the first time. And this is a crazy good exchange. Emiya wasn't even talking directly to her to begin with. He was talking through Iris to her, because he said that she shouldn't even talk directly with a scumbag like him. And he was sitting there smiling to Iris, saying that this is the first time that you've seen the way he killed. And it's like damn near disturbing seeing him like smile through that shit. But you can tell his pain behind it. But then the real gold here is actually finding out what Emiya thinks of the world and his role in it. We all know by now that Saber has this real justice-oriented, knight-like mindset. And we kind of know that Emiya don't really see, like her and Emiya don't really see eye to eye to begin with. But they both had one common goal, and that's to save the world. But here is where we actually get to see the difference in their methods of saving the world. See, where Saber plans on taking on all the world's sins and negativity and still taking the tragic hero route and still trying to do good and carry on that burden, Emmy, on the other hand, plans to do the same thing, but taking on that evil negativity and bringing upon a darker version of justice, where he seemingly kills all the people that he thinks need to be killed and the people in his way of making the world peaceful. And instead of playing the hero role, he's perfectly fine with being looked at as his true embodiment of evil and complete darkness. He's completely ready to be scapegoated, and it only makes you think like, damn, who hurt you, nigga? Like, what the hell? Might as well stay on the topic of Emiya. And you didn't have to wait too long to figure out who hurt him, because the next two episodes after this was Emiya backstory episodes. And damn, boy. And remember what I said earlier? Like, we ain't know shit about his pain yet? Yeah, this is what I was referring to. So, Emiya started off as a pretty normal child, right? He grew up with his father and his close friend Shirley. His father was pretty much outcasted by the rest of the island because he practices magic, but Shirley still worked under him as an associate. One thing that his dad works on is his medicine that makes things immortal, and Shirley wanted to prove that Emiya's dad wasn't such a bad person by using the medicine on herself. But when it backfires and she turns into a ghoul, the whole village gets infected and everyone he knows and loves dies. He confronts his father about it, and this nigga, Emiya's father, has zero remorse or feels zero sympathy for all the lives that he's ruined. And he just prioritizes escaping with his son and then continuing this fucked up research and possibly experimenting on more people in the future, causing more death. Emiya has a shorty. Mind you, Emiya probably like 9-10 years old here. Emiya has a shorty, kills his father with no hesitation, despite him fully being aware of his emotions and how he feels about doing it. And one of these ladies that helped him eliminate the ghouls, named Natalia, ends up taking him under her wing. So that's pretty bad already, right? Nigga, we ain't done. So, with his first body being his father, ever since, he's been killing niggas at an extremely young age. He's been killing niggas as a shorty. And he's been watching innocent niggas die since he was a kid too. So basically, he's been turned into this ruthless killing machine. As he's growing the bond with his master, you would think, like, at least he has her, right? Hell no, she gets trapped on a plane full of ghouls. And I ain't gonna lie, this shit was funny as hell, but it's messed up too. This nigga, he drives the boat to where the plane gonna fly past and pulls a javelin out and RPG that bitch out of the sky, killing his master and everyone on that plane. Like, god damn, this nigga life is horrible. Jesus Christ. Still ain't over. Fast forward to the present, bro. They go back to the present after the backstory episodes are over. Emiya's wife, Iris, is dying. He visits his dying wife, and he knows she's about to die very soon. Like, just naturally. Like, she's about to revert back to her grail concept homunculus form. That makes sense. His subordinate and his other lover dies as well. And his currently dying wife gets fucking upgraded to expedited shipping and ends up dying to the hands of his worst enemy. Gang. Bro, Emiya is a pretty solid contender for worst life in anime, but I guess his story could have ended worse. At least after the aftermath of the war, he actually saved someone, which is all that he really ever wanted, which was beautiful. But the iceberg, because he didn't want the grill, they're not letting him see his daughter. So he lost his daughter, Ilya, as well, too, which is crazy. Now, let's talk about some plot twists. Because there were some crazy ones in here, I'm not going to lie. Gilgamesh instigating to the point where Kire betrayed Ren's father is crazy. Because it makes you think if Gilgamesh didn't pry, if this nigga would just shut the fuck up, Kire probably wouldn't have acted on any of this, in my opinion. Thus limited some of the unnecessary bloodshed throughout this war. He really a funny ass nigga, but he can't be mad though, because he said that this was all for his entertainment at the beginning of the war. And he really meant that shit. Lives don't mean shit to him. Berserker being Sir Lancelot was a pretty surprising one, and it clears up something from earlier on in the story, and I love how they did this. I'm pretty sure there was a moment when they were fighting, it was a Rider, Lancer, and Saber fighting Caster. This is like Caster's final stand, and I'm pretty sure like Gilgamesh and Berserker were fighting, and in the middle of the fight, Berserker just fucking aggro Saber like the Godskin duo or some shit. And like, I was like, why did he do that? It made me like confused, and I think Waver was even confused. And it was a hell of a mystery, but it makes sense now. It makes a lot of sense now why he did that. Gilgamesh getting the physical form in the world is so wild, but I'm here for it. He brings an amazing energy to the show, and I'm glad he came back and stayed night. This is a little bit more of a light one, but the old guy finding out that Waver isn't actually his grandson is actually pretty wholesome too. I ain't gonna lie, my fault, gang. I need to throw something lighthearted there, bro. This show dark as hell. There was actually one thing that I couldn't wrap my head around, and it was Iris and her relationship with the grill itself. So I know she's like the concept of the grill, and I think I get the whole sequence. Like, I get the whole sequence with Emiya being shown his inner self by the grill and him refusing it, but what does Ilya's dream, Iris, and the grill all have in common? I really can't make sense of it, because that was like a pretty like convoluted part right there. I'm pretty sure it's some cheat code that I would never know in my life. So comment down below if you know, because I would like to know like the lore on that. But otherwise, Phase Zero easily has one of the best narratives I've ever followed. And that doesn't just go for anime. I mean in all the fictional media that I've consumed in my life so far, which is crazy to say. But it's true. Hey, you there. If you made it this far into the video, first off, I would like to say thank you. And second off, you gotta be enjoying this motherfucker. So do me a favor, hit that like subscribe button. If you're this far in and you here just to hate, I congratulate you too. You're probably one of the most patient dick eaters on the planet, and I appreciate the watch time. goofy. Now, let's move on to characters and character interactions. Saying the characters in Fate are good is like a major understatement. I genuinely believe that every character we meet in this show is super interesting, with a couple exceptions. So let's talk about these servants and masters. Obviously, we gotta start with the GOAT, bro. Emiya damn near my favorite anime character of all time. I love how much of a savage folks is, and I appreciate how realistic he is, because we don't see a lot of characters in anime with a mindset like he has. I'm not gonna lie, I know I stay saying this, but this trope gonna hit every single time. He's super relatable, man. He's not just some ice cold killer nigga like Kira is. When Emiya kills niggas, although if he doesn't show it immediately, that shit been weighing on his mind his whole life since he was a shorty, gang. The Grail has already showed us this, and he even showed us this in his refusal of the Grail as well. He's been put into so many situations where he's had to sacrifice loved ones, or the situation where his loved ones died right in front of him, and he's cried every time it's happened, signifying that this is some shit that he's tired of. He's tired of losing loved ones. Look at what he said when he adopted Shiro. He said that Ilya was the last thing he was ever gonna lose, and he meant that shit. Me knowing what loss feel like, obviously not to this scale, of course. I hate that feeling, I'm not gonna lie. You never really get used to a person you love and fuck with so much just not being there. There's always gonna be some trigger or something that you always used to do with them that's gonna familiarize you with the damn, they're gone type feeling. You get tired of that shit. You get angry at how the world is, and you start looking for methods to prevent it from happening again. But ultimately, you realize that even if a person was taken away from you prematurely, that's just how the world is. And in the process, it makes you want to protect what you have right now in front of you. And that's exactly what he did. Emiya getting some kind of closure is pretty good to see, gang. I love the exchange at the very end between him and Shiro. He tells Shiro that he can't be a hero no more. And he explains and says because being a hero has a time limit. He's long past it. And Shiro said to him, that's fine, I'll just be a hero for you. That statement must have gave Emiya an immeasurable amount of like relief and like relaxation. Especially since at that moment during like all that hero talk, he probably was just thinking about how much shit he's lost and how much shit he's destroyed and the lives that he's taken away. So I'm really glad to finally see him A, not be alone, and B, be able to live his actual dream throughout his son. I think that's pretty rough. Emiya is a phenomenal ass character, bro. And his ideals may seem crazy at first, but once you see his circumstances, it makes a lot of sense because he's seen way more shit than I've seen. I think Saber's pretty cool too. Although she's extremely stubborn at Phase Zero, I genuinely think that her ideals are some that I have as well, or used to, I should say. She'd be wanting to just take on the burdens of everyone around her and just play that tragic hero role. She feels responsible for everyone's problems. And although that's like a super good guy way to approach things, it's just simply not realistic. It's just too much for one to handle. Like, that's why you need to keep good company. What's that saying? It takes a village, and a village means that people have their own strengths and their own will to fight for themselves too. It's already hard enough to bear the weight of your own burdens and sins, so taking on other people's has to be exhausting. And Saber eventually realized that Ryder was frying her ass. There was some truth to what he was saying, although he lost her. The way Saber's story ended in Phase Zero was actually pretty unfortunate though, because she was transported back square into her biggest regret and her biggest failure while retaining the memories of the Grail War. Not being able to understand Emiya and why he told her to destroy the Grail, and just not getting why he used the command seals and made her do that with no reason and nothing like that. And also dealing with the pain of not getting her wish granted, of undoing her failure in general and being just square back in what she wants to undo and why she participated in it. It's kind of wild. Saber is a really cool character too, and I enjoyed every bit of her. Like, even though she wasn't like the most emotionally intelligent and like kind of stubborn person in the roster, I like Saber a lot. Ryder and Waver are a really good duo. I don't think I really paid too much attention to their friendship on my first watch, but after finishing this a second time, I've really grown to like and appreciate them. Ryder is like a big brother to Waver, and Waver is just kind of like trying to prove himself to Ryder secretly. But it's a trade-off though. Ryder lacks knowledge of the world that he's in, and Waver is lacking in ideas of what strength looks like, and they're able to make up for what each other lack. One of my favorite moments between the two is definitely when Waver tried to drop out of the war and use all his command spells because he felt like he was holding Ryder back. And Ryder lets him know, like, he wants him to charge into battle with him because he's still his friend. Him telling Waver to live on and see his dream through is pretty cool, especially considering that Waver plans on traveling now, which is a pretty small detail that I thought was really dope. Ryunosuke and Caster might be the sickest duo in all of fiction. These two niggas should have never met each other. I'd rather have Tommy, Kanan, Kane, and Ghost running through the streets of Chicago than to ever let Castor and Yunusuke link up again, nigga. These two niggas ain't even know about the Grail or the Holy Grail War in general. They was just killing kids the entire time with their sick ass. Castor know he wrong for doing that little boy like that. Castor know he wrong for that shit. He really set that little nigga free and greeted him with a gold camo customer service smile just to watch folks hit that corner and get baited right into a Lethal Company monster. Shorty was on maps and didn't let know that the Bracken was right around that damn corner. I'm glad they got them out of there, bro. I'm not gonna lie. The thought of, like, it's crazy because they burned down their lair and Ryunosuke had the nerve to say, why would God let someone do this? Like, folks, you dead ass? nigga Tombo, we must replenish our supplies. He's talking about children, my guy. Matter of fact, he almost got ran too. So there was almost no face stay night just because of these two. Tokiomi was a pretty horrible nigga too, gang. First off, he was trying to betray Gilgamesh and he was about to use his command spells to make him kill himself like Kanan did Lancer. And in his face off with Kariya, he reveals his motive behind sending Sakura off to the Mato house. And it's really trash, extremely trash. So basically, he sent her off so her and Ren could eventually have a battle in the future, right? Instead of, you know, being a normal, compassionate parent and loving both of your daughters and training them to both become good mages himself, he made it so the winner of their eventual battle would end up being the one he claims, essentially throwing away the other one. As a man, this shit disgusts me, nigga. I'm already overprotective about my daughter and her ass don't even exist yet. So seeing this nigga treat his daughters like some damn 4-star prospects is like nasty work to me, folks. There are some seemingly good moments from him in the beginning, but honestly, it seemed like it was all a lie. I feel bad for Ren, but we smoking on his pack regardless. I'm not gonna lie. Tokiomi's a bitch. I'm not gonna lie. Now we move on to the man himself. None other than Chief Executive Officer of Dick Riding Incorporated, Mr. Kure. My God, this dude is an awful person. I mean, where do I start? If he didn't pursue Emiya, a lot less blood would have been shed. This nigga done deceived everyone in the show. He saved Kariya just to end up framing him from Tokiomi's death. And he probably had arranged Aoi to pull up, damn near getting her killed in the process. And he and Gilgamesh was just sitting on the balcony watching all this unfold, by the way. He killed Ren's father after promising Ren that he'll take care of him and make sure that he doesn't get hurt. He killed Iris for damn near no reason. She was already reverting back to her Grail form anyway, and he only kidnapped her to find out Emmy's wish was for the Grail. Gang, the dick eating is crazy. Not only did he kill Ren's father, the nigga had the nerve to be the priest at the funeral. And not only was he was the priest at the funeral, but this grimy nigga got the nerve to give Ren the knife that he killed him with to her as a present. Like, what kind of sick and demented nigga? Bro, what you on? But I'm not gonna lie, he's a pretty good antagonist figure because you hated that nigga. You hated that nigga when you watched this, folks. So I would say they did a pretty good job with him. I'm not gonna lie, I gotta talk about Gilgamesh, gang. Gilgamesh is a pretty funny nigga, gang. I'm not gonna lie. If we keep it a bean, he's just as horrible as Kire, but he's just funny. He is like a funny asswipe, so it makes him way more likable. I don't think King of Heroes is the proper title for this nigga anymore. I think he should just be referred to as the King of Instigating. He might give my nigga Josh a run for his money, but then again, I feel like if he threw a bro number in that bitch, things probably could have turned out even worse, so I don't know. The thing is with Gilgamesh that you can't even be mad at the nigga for real because he already told you that he doing all this for purely entertainment. He didn't even care about the Grail War or the Holy Grail. He didn't care about either one of them shit. He cared about seeing what humans did. At the same time, it's wild. It's like they wrote him pretty well because he's not entirely an evil being. Otherwise, Waverass would probably be dead. And he probably could have just slaughtered everyone in the show with his noble phantasm. So he's definitely horrible, but I can't call him 100% evil. Now let's move on to the looks, presentation, and music. As the title says, Phase Zero is around 13 years old, which is absolutely insane. Cause there's a lot of anime that's coming out now and airing right now and coming out in 2024 that can't hold a candle to this shit. Phase Zero is damn near flawless when it comes to visual. That might be the most visually pleasing anime out there along with its counterparts, of course. It wouldn't be me if we didn't talk about the fights, folks. So let's talk about a few of my favorites. Emiya versus Kirei has a really good argument to be considered one of the best fights in the series. It was no super flashy magic attacks. There were no noble phantasm or reality marbles that transport you to big battlefields. This shit was just hands, guns, and choreography, actually. It's super impressive to have all these really flashy fights with hella magic and crazy attacks and shit, and the fight between two masters finds a way to stand out for itself. This was disgusting. Emiya's reality marble powers are really well utilized, and Kirei's martial arts made this unforgettable, folks. I love the setting of this fight, too. They basically fought in that place where all the rappers be shooting music videos, folks, and they made a classic in the same location, which is funny as hell. Ryder versus Assassin was godlike, too. Reality marbles are just goated, gang. Ryder using his reality marble to transfer all the assassins to this huge, like, deserted battlefield with, like, nowhere to hide was, like, a really good strategy move, first off, and it just looked really cool. And then you see, like, seeing all the armies that he conquered under his command charge, literally just, like, millions of servants, folks. Hawk down all those assassins was just raw as hell to me. And it made it even better that it was just a flex to saber. Like, I think that was like partially like a flex to saber, because that was when they had that discussion of what a king is. The whole scramble with Ryder, Lancer, and Saber versus Caster was goaded as well. I love the fight between Berserker and Gilgamesh that was going on while this is happening. The main thing I remember from this fight is Lancer lifting Saber's curse and then seeing Saber use Excalibur for the first time. It's not much shit in anime that you're gonna see that's gonna be prettier than this, gang. This was just a phenomenal moment, and the music that they played during this sequence was absolutely godlike as well, bro. The choirs, the fucking chorus, oh my god, the orchestra, it just did a really good job of setting the tone of that scene. Ryder versus Gilgamesh was pretty fire too, because we got to see that same reality marble that I think is so cool get destroyed in an instant by Gilgamesh's noble phantasm. This fight did a good job at showing us how nasty this nigga Gilgamesh is, and how big the difference in power was between him and Ryder. It's beauty behind the destruction of his reality marble, and the music really just sells the finale of this fight extremely well. I love this fight. As a nigga that used to skip anime intros because they be having spoilers, I never heard like the intro songs before when I watched anime. But now that I realize that Twitter has taken that spot in my life for spoiling me, I just started running through the intros, and the Phase Zero intros and outros are great. I don't know who made the outro songs for Emiya's backstory episodes. Gee, y'all did shot of shit, boy. New songs are so good. I'm finna add them all to the Rigato playlist. So, you know, link in the description for that, if I remember to put it in there. The music in the show is really good. Everything matches musically the epic shit that I see on my screen. So great job to you, Photo Boo. Great job to the chorus that sung. Great job to the instrumentalists that played, and the creators of the intro and outro songs as well. Y'all all did a phenomenal job. And the voice actors too. Let's not forget the voice actors. Y'all did a great job as well. I'm so glad that I revisited Phase Zero again. The first time that I watched it, I was like watching it with my homies, and it was like I was super impatient and not really locked into the story as much as I should have been. But even so, that still led to me thinking that this is one of the best anime ever, which is crazy. And I didn't even get the full experience. Now that I've revisited it and my brain is like way past the action only phase and I no longer have the attention span of a hush puppy, I was able to experience the show in all of its glory. This show is way better on my second watch, like exponentially better. It's always fun putting together puzzles that you couldn't put together before, and the show's growth, it helps you look at past things differently, and maybe you even look at them in a completely different way. And that's how I felt kind of watching Phase Zero again. So yes, to answer your question, Phase Zero is still good 13 years later, my nigga. That's crazy. And honestly, you should go rewatch it too. That's all for me, gang. As always, man, I hope y'all have a great day, man. Love y'all, man. Peace. Sometimes we seem to disagree. Pray that you protect the end that creates my sympathy. I'm a mini you, one day I'll have a mini me. I'm your son, I shouldn't treat you like an enemy. I get annoyed when you point out all